7:45, we'll call the meeting to order, and we do have a forum present. City manager? Cheers.
So, council, tonight we want to once again visit with you about the proposed bond program. I have a couple of people here. Julie Partain is our bond counsel, and she's here to answer any specific questions. And Bob Bonahan is going to walk you very quickly through some additional information we have on the multi-generational center. And then I'm going to walk you through various options. It's really important, and there's an item on your regular agenda also, to give us final direction on what needs to be in the ordinance, because we have to call the ordinance at the next meeting, or you can't vote an election in. With that, I'm going to turn it over to Bob and let him quickly walk you through this multi-generational center concept.
Thank you, Donna. What we did on this, based on your comments after touring the other center, we got with the architect to get the concept, look at the space needs and cost of construction. And so what we're looking at is putting the facility in Memorial Park using the existing senior center and recreation center and adding on to that for a multi-generational center to service all age groups, and using that with the themes that we have from the Vision 2025 of the green centerpiece and extending the green, tying into that and use the park area across the street to carry that concept all the way through everything that we're doing. And to really begin to use this as an outreach for Leela and all the education process we do in Leela. So from the start with the design, once we get there, we want to take a look at trying to incorporate the nature-inspired theme all the way through. And there's a lot of different ways we might be able to do it. We're going to have a playground is what's planned to be on the inside. So I have a nature theme on the kids' playground on the inside. The concept is to have it open and airy and bright. There may be some ways. This is showing possibility of a lobby area. There might be ways to have some type of mural, wildflowers or something that carries the theme through. Out back, you know, we're trying to preserve the oak trees that are behind the senior center. There may be a way with that to have a little nice gathering area out back and incorporate that into it. So here's the existing site as it is today, Senior Center, Memorial Park, Rec Center. So when we take a look at the site, I was pleased to see that it doesn't impact the open areas as much as we originally thought it was going to. So we're going to have plenty of space to put it out there. The red is the existing facilities. White is going to be the addition. Over here and here we're showing the estimated additional parking needs that we're going to have. It impacts very little of the trees out back here, and the trail will have to be relocated. But that's pretty much it when you take a look at that. So that's just another look at it, a little bit closer up. This has just different colors, so you can see the different rooms that are in the floor plan. Again, this is a concept. Once we get into the design stage, we'll work through a lot of the different room areas on it. This slide that you have shows a basic concept of what we discussed earlier. Here's a possible aquatic area that might possibly be a second phase. This side of the facility would have the bulk of the senior programming in it. It's got an event space with the stage at the end and then a backstage classroom area. But one of the things when we get into design, that I'm talking about is just the concept, we may have to move around a little bit. Here's the kitchen space. We may want the event space closer to the kitchen space and just flip it. We've got indoor play, child watch station, existing gym, new gym, and some fitness areas. There's, right now, there's a lag for additional classroom space down here. And we want to look at moving some of those active fitness areas, which would be for Zumba or aerobics, that type of thing, up into this space, which is too big, which is where the fitness area would be. We would move it up there, utilize the area downstairs for the added classroom space. And of course, it shows the walking and jogging trail around the upstairs area around the gym. So that's pretty much an overview of the space that's in there. So then we look at the play concepts at the park across the street. I might need Eric's help here.
Yeah, it's his TV. The Zoom.
That didn't do it.
There we go.
I'm out there. So we don't want to go with just a traditional park setting that you see with normal playground equipment. We want to focus on what is nature play. We want to be able to get out and enjoy the natural aspects of the park area and be able to connect with nature and discover what's there.
We're going to have training.
Some of us aren't turning the ball on this one. Every time I touch it, it gets
one finger.
So just real quickly on some of the thoughts on the park, some initial thoughts. We want a trail to go through. The perimeter trail we're looking at being a hard surface trail, and then interior soft surface, decomposed granite. The perimeter trail being hard surface, that makes it usable in any weather, any time of the year. But it gives us some other opportunities. We could use dyes to color it toward the natural earth. And we can steal from Bass Pro and put animal footprints in the pavement. Use that for educational exploration. We can put leaf prints in it and do a lot with that. And one of the things that we're looking at doing is expanding our summer camp program over at Memorial Park to include time here at the park and work with some of our legal staff to have some educational opportunities over here. This is the blank space that's existing with no trees. Be some type of a parking area over there. I don't know how large. And we certainly want to have an area, a couple of gathering areas. Here it says pavilion. It may not be a traditional pavilion as such, because we're not necessarily looking at having family reunions and picnics out there. Might put another gathering area down here, so when we have summer camps come around, we could utilize those. They put water in here. I don't necessarily see any water out there. We don't have any now. So it's just a concept that we would have to take a look at. So we want them to discover with the items that are there and be able to climb on them, whatever it might be. We're not looking at rope climbers, but we're looking for something different. We want them to be able to touch what's out there. There may be opportunities to jump, but again, not like the traditional playground. Ballast, there could be a tree trunk that fell out there naturally that we clean up and let them climb on and use for balance. We want opportunities for them to dream and explore. There's a lot of different things we might be able to do with that. Again, I don't think there'll be water, but there'll certainly be trail areas. Smell. We've been working with the Land O'Lakes Garden Club for a number of years, next to the senior center with butterfly garden. We may be able to expand that over into the park area. We wanted to watch what's out there and the changing seasons out there, whether it's the color in the trees, dropping the leaves, watching the animals that are out there and what the changes are, and to be aware of it. We wanted to learn and have different opportunities, different ways for them to learn, whatever that may be, and play. And it's okay to get involved out there and in play in the different areas and get dirty. We want them to listen. I have a different concept than what the architect did on this. I don't want to see cowbells clanging out there.
Everything needs more cowbell.
What I would like to see is some way we come up with them to be able to listen to the sounds of nature and what's out there and what's around them. Everybody knows what a squirrel is. They see them all over the place. But how many kids have actually sat and realized that noise up there in the tree is a squirrel sitting up there barking at them? Or it might be a mockingbird, or it might be the crickets chirping or something. We possibly could do that with interpretive signage and a button that you push to identify it. Gathering areas, instead of a traditional pavilion, it might be just some type of area to gather. It might be, instead of a picnic table or benches, to sit on a pile of rocks, where you could have a group just gather and sit out there. That's more of a natural type setting. We want to be able to experience the art that's in nature, not necessarily like this. There may be a bunch of different ways to incorporate art, but that's yet to be explored. And then we just put some other additional ideas that are out there. Signage, we certainly want to have some type of a natural material for the signage to be able to use that. That's certainly possible working with our Leela friend, being able to put something up out there. And so we just had some ideas here as far as the concept to work with in the future.
So that's the multi-generational concept. That's it tying in to the property across the street. So you have a total vision and concept for what could be. Obviously, we'll come back to you if you call the election and if the bonds are actually approved, with more of a SHREC process so that you can look at the total concept. But again, we wanted to show you how this type of project can actually tie in so well with the 2025 objectives. So to turn your attention to program overall cost, what you see up on the PowerPoint, what you saw up on the PowerPoint, there it is again. This is the original program that was recommended by the Blue Ribbon Bond Committee, $117.7 million program, about a penny, 1.3 cent increase over your current debt rate. If you'll go to the next slide. This shows you what we talked about most recently, and that is adding the cost of the multi-generational facility, the $25.1 million. Cost, but then you see that what changed was the cost of the senior center, new recreation center, and Heron Rec Center were all actually folded into really the multi-generational concept. In addition, if you remember from our last conversation, the EOC, I actually decreased that based on some input that Julie got from the AG's office, that we can only fund that part of the basement that's specifically related to the EOC center. So that dropped the public safety part of your project. So you then had a $122 million program. That is about a 1.4 cent increase over your current rate. Finally, if you go to the next one, what we're doing, the addition you see here is that aquatic facility. In the program that Bob showed you, you saw space dedicated to aquatics. the estimate we have from the architect of an aquatic facility similar to Grapevine's is about a $13 million program. So if you were to add that to the overall project, you're going to raise your overall program to $135 million. It raises your debt rate to less than a 2 cent increase in total. And I want to stop and just talk about that a minute, because when we talk about the impact on your debt rate, we're talking about it based on some very conservative assumptions. We're talking about a 3% TAV increase, and we're talking about it being sold over 10 years. Now, in reality, our assessed values have increased close to 5% over the last 10 years. And in addition, if you remember the last program, we sold that debt over a longer period than 10 years. So if you wanted to say that this program would only be issued with no impact to the tax rate, you could do so. You would just probably need to extend the number of years that the program exists. And my guess is that would probably extend it to 12 or 13 year program. So those are your options. You go to the last slide, so there's your comparison, that conservative estimate of the impact on your debt rate. And I was talking to Julie. Julie has been visiting with the AG's office on the program and the various elements of the program. And she does have an interesting perspective that she's gotten from them now on public art. Julie, would you share that with the council?
Sure. Just to verify that the AG thought it was okay for you to include public art within propositions the way that you did, if you'll remember the way we're currently thinking about the propositions, it would say something like, police and public safety facilities, including police facilities, fire facilities, emergency facilities, and the installation of public art related thereto, or something like that. And the AG has said that yes, in general, they're fine with that, but they want to make sure that the public art is basically a permanent public improvement that is part of the construction of the building. So, for example, I think that a mural on the side of the building would be fine. I think that a fountain integrated into the hardscaping of the landscape is fine. I think that an alcove on the outside wall with an affixed statue is fine. But in particular, in their email to me, the AG said that they have difficulty finding a nexus between a freestanding statue that is just stuck out in the yard that is not part of the construction of the project. So does that make sense? If it's part of the structure, I think I'm okay with it. If you just want to put a statue of a police dog on the front lawn of the police station, I think they have a problem with that being a capital project you can spend bond money on. That's kind of, it's a little bit of an odd distinction, but that's kind of where they come down on it.
Which is, I know cities have done differently, but that's their...
Well, I will say that I know that both Fort Worth and Dallas have an internal policy adopted many, many years ago that they take a certain percentage of bond proceeds and they put it to public art. Okay? That was not voted. That's an internal policy, and that's never been seen by the Attorney General. So Centerdale doesn't know what they're doing with that money. And it was not something I can tell you from Dallas that they ran by their bond council at the time that they did it either. Because if you ask me, can we do public art, I would say it has to be a capital project that is a fixture that has the estimated life of the building. That's kind of what a capital bond project is. So I can't really speak to what other cities do and whether or not they got caught doing it, but when you ask the AG the question, this is the answer that you get from them, which is that you can do it. There are just some parameters. I just want to make sure that it's part of the construction of the actual facility.
You have about $840,000 in your program dedicated to public art. So just know, I think it's still very valid. We'd just be somewhat more limited than we had originally thought at how last year was done. That's correct. So council, that's your options to look at. So again, what you have to do by the 17th is call the election. We have to pass an ordinance that has the propositions outlined. So I've got an item on the regular agenda for you to give us direction as to what you want to have included in that ordinance. So I just wanted to make sure we're very clear before we get to the 17th meeting on what your preferences are. turn it back to you, Mayor.
How far can we go on discussion, Council, on this?
On this?
Yeah.
You can discuss.
Okay.
You can't vote.
Any questions or comments? We'll start with you, Neil.
All those in favor?
We'll find out here in a minute. Neil, if you have any questions or comments?
No, I've gone over this back and forth and upside down, and Donna and I have spent time together, and I'm pretty clear on all of it.
I guess my question is, what is the life expectancy of Sun Valley and usage and everything if we're putting one a mile down the road from it?
Yeah, the distinction I would make with Sun Valley and what you'd be building at Memorial Park is one is an outdoor aquatic facility, and this is strictly an indoor aquatic facility. So there is a distinction. The life of Sun Valley would be certainly 25 plus years. You're right, they would be very close. But again, Sun Valley is just open, it's seasonal, it's only open designated months. This aquatic facility would be open 12 months a year, the indoor facility. And if you remember, and one of the cities, I believe it's Flower Mound, you saw they built together an indoor with an outdoor.
Right.
So you just have some separation.
Okay.
I will also point out the one concern is not only are you going to have the cost related to this bond program, remember what they talked about in Grapevine. To run an indoor aquatic facility is going to be very expensive, and you're going to have a fairly large impact, and I don't have a number for you on that. I'd have to step back and run some calcs and talk to Grapevine, but you're going to have some operating costs that could decrease.
TJ?
I love the idea of, especially the space that we bought, the outdoor playscape, that nature play concept. Love it. I think that's an outstanding use for that acreage. I talked with Bob a little bit about construction and whatnot, if this goes through, and of course we're going to have some unique challenges there, because I would imagine we're not going to be building around the existing spaces. We would be building a whole new. So we'll have to, there'll be some cost incurred with being shifting the senior activities and those types of things. And that might create some agita, but I think I'd rather do that and move through it as fast as we can than do it in a wraparound type of process with the expenses.
Those facilities would become part of the new building, just like they did in Grapevine.
Okay, so we would work that way.
Yes.
All right.
Yep.
I'm not a fan of the water, the indoor water. We have access to the auditorium, the big, beautiful new building just another mile down the road that has year-round facilities.
I don't think that's available to the general public.
You can. There are hours. It is
very,
limited.
Very limited. I've talked to the people that go there.
Sure.
With their kids. There's three high schools using it now, and there's very, very limited space.
There is.
And times. And
I'll agree with that, but there is public access.
And it's more lap lanes. You know, this is more of a play type.
To me, these other cities that we went and looked at, they added the water because that's their only water facility, and they don't have Sun Valley or College, which are phenomenal facilities. So we have something currently that they don't have. Plus, we have a splash-esque pad going in right across the street. So we have other water facilities. My challenge is the more the M&O and the cost per capita on an indoor water facility. I mean, you're spending an awful lot of money per user of that facility when you really break it down to the numbers. The chemicals, the painting, I mean,
it's expensive.
The amount of money you want to find out, look at the amount of money we spend on Sun Valley every year.
The employees.
Yeah.
That's
significant impact.
All of that. So for me, I love the space. I love the outdoor. The water thing can be a phase two if we want to go that route, but I have really no interest in seeing that in the first part.
No, I'm on the same page. I mean, I'm not, and we've talked about the phase two aspect of the aquatics, and so that's.
I like designing it so we could have that future option.
Yep.
And if residents really decide that that's where they want to go, then.
Well, before we get to Leroy, on that deal, would you like to have that an option on the bond that's coming up. That face, that the indoor water part would be just a secondary option. And if the first one passed for the center, then the second one could be voted on.
Just do it as a line item.
And then you talk to Julie about that, how that could be written. Julie, you want to describe that?
There are three ways that I can think about doing it, and one of them, I only hesitate in the sense that I would have to talk about with the AG. I mean, you can have a proposition for your for park and rec facilities, and you can have a separate proposition for indoor water recreation facilities. You can certainly do that. If they both pass, that's great. You don't have to build either one. You never have to issue debt. You can always just not use it. If your park and rec, your regular park and rec failed, but your aquatic passed, and that's not what you want to do, you would just never issue that debt. I mean, I think the only consideration might be a political one. If you had pressure from your citizens, it passed, why aren't you building it? That would be the only, but legally you could do that. You wouldn't be forced to build it. You know, I have seen in years past, it's been a while since I've seen it, some sort of contingency in your election order that says, you know, if you would vote on the aquatic proposition, but then say to your voters, we would only build it if Proposition 1 passes, which would be your park and rec. Now, I guess my only concern with that one and why I hesitate slightly is, you know, you can't do a dual proposition, meaning you can't say to voters in one proposition, do you want a library and a fire station? Because that puts them in a bind. Well, what if I want the library but not the fire station? I have to vote for the fire station to get the library. In a way, you're kind of doing that in a sense when you vote the aquatic center and you say you want an aquatic center, and do you want a park and rec? But then you tell them, but I'm not going to build the aquatic unless I build a park and rec. Well, what if I just want an aquatic center and I don't want a park and rec facility? Kind of haven't I done a fib and end run about that? Still, that being said, because I think you could actually do two separate propositions and then just not issue one, I think you likely could do it, but I wouldn't want to run that by the AG and make sure they believe that. Now, there's a third way to slice that apple, which is, other than putting it in your election ordinance, you could pass a resolution and say, we are not going to build the aquatic center if we don't have the other one. And you can make a binding contract with the voters. If you pass it and this is the will of the council, then that's binding on you. You say, we're never going to issue this debt, or we're absolutely going to issue this debt. If you say that in an official motion, that would bind you to do it. Just passing a bond proposition doesn't bind you to ever issue debt. You can issue it any way you want to. But if you were to put out some binding statements that said, we promise we're never going to issue this debt, well, you would be making a contract with the voters at that point that would be enforceable. So there's a couple of different ways to do it. My preference, if you were asking me what do I think gives you the most latitude and is the cleanest way to do it, would be to just vote two propositions and see what happens. And if they both pass, you don't have to build the aquatic center. You can build it later. You can never build it. If one or the other fail, if the Parks and Rec fails and the aquatic passes, again, you don't have to do it. If the aquatic fails and the Parks and Rec passes, well, you just build a park and rec facility and you go back to the voters later again for try again with your aquatic. Plus, if you do two propositions and your aquatic center passes but your park doesn't, which I guess is the concern, your aquatic center is passed. It's there. You can always go back to the voters again for your park and rec facility. So, I mean, that to me is the cleaner way to do it, is just have two propositions, let them pass, and then make a decision as to which one you want to do. But if you want to move forward and you want to make them contingent on each other, I will do my best to work through that with the AG and see if we can't make that happen.
Can you do it both ways, as far as, so we can pick which one we want to do?
Yes.
Do it so that they're tied together, and do the one that they're completely independent of each other.
You could make it so that you have an proposition that's park and recreation, and that's your total number. So aquatics would be included, and it would be $52 million. Or you could do one separate. I think what Julie's saying, and so it would be your $39 million. Then you'd have a fourth item on your ballot that would be aquatic. That would be the cleanest.
But if you voted it contingent, Mayor, if you said in your aquatic center, we will only do this if the first one passes.
Like this is the proposition. This
concern,
is an add-on to it.
Right. I guess my only concern there, thinking off the top of my head, which is always dangerous, is if you say to the voter, we're going to do the, we will do the aquatic center if the park and rec proposition passes. So the park and rec proposition passes, and then you decide you don't want to do the aquatic center. You might have a bit of a problem there because you had said we would do it if the other one passed. And now you're deciding you're not going to do it. You may have boxed yourself in a little bit there and forcing yourself to do it.
I think that the worst thing I could see happening right now is that you say if the aquatic center doesn't, or it does pass, but the rec center does not.
Right. And
that's the worst thing I think could happen right now. And then our only alternative is to not build it.
Right.
Because it's going to take the place of some part of the rec center, isn't it? If it was on the same plan that was there.
Correct.
Whereas we could build the rec center and not build the pool. That would work on its own. But then we'd have to tell people, oh, well, you voted for the aquatic center. We're not going to do it because you didn't pass the other part.
Right.
I would rather say that up front, that here's the rec center. For an additional amount of money, here's what we'd like to have in that, but it's a separate vote that's going on.
Because it's an add-on,
so
not a library.
It's an amendment to it.
In other words, let me think about it this way. Could we have a proposition that says, construction of city park and rec facilities, including indoor water recreation facilities, for $29 million. And then you have a second proposition that says, park and recreation facilities and open spaces for whatever that smaller number is, $25 million. So you're passing your park and rec facility both ways. Just one of them you're passing it with water and one of them it's without. Is that what you're saying?
We could do that. I was thinking more of an addendum to the recreation part.
A and A1.
An A and A1, but they're tied together. That if you want to pass this, you want to pass this, you can either vote yes or no, or no or no, or whatever.
How is that different from having just two propositions, one for the rec center?
What if they both pass? Do you only get to vote for one? I don't know.
So what prevents you with the aquatics from saying that it is the bond, this bond adds aquatics to the park and rec facility proposal? Cannot be built without that construction.
I'm sorry, I'm not following you.
Well, you can't build. In other words, the bond states that in choosing this option, you're choosing something that cannot be constructed without the approval.
He's saying you would define the aquatics item and leave it.
That it's a limitation of how you can build it.
I get the library versus fire department. I think where I'm going is, it's not library versus fire department, it's fire department for four trucks versus fire department for six trucks.
Mm-hmm. Well, let me say this, we're also what plays into the mix is what you want to show your voters and how your voters want to vote on it or how you want to present it. Because a water portion of an indoor recreation, I mean, that is, you can describe an indoor recreation and park facility without specifically calling out water. And you could just put the whole amount of money. But if you wanted to be, I guess, completely transparent, or you just think you would need to have that in there for some reason, it is a park and recreation facility. I mean, in my mind, you can lump it all together and vote it as $29 million. But my understanding is that you wanted to separate them out for some reason.
Perhaps.
But you don't have to. I mean, you can say, you can vote it all together and call water. You could follow, I mean, there's lots of different ways to skin this cat. It just
what we're talking about, what are the two numbers right now?
So the Parks and Recreation number in total is $39.9 million.
Okay.
That includes the water.
No, it is not. That includes your...
Well, let me ask the question. The total... you're doing the whole... That's going to be the proposition, whatever number it is.
That's your trails and all of that. Right.
Yeah, if you want the total, everything with the aquatics, it's $52.9
million. Okay.
If you
go to the park and rec right there, the 39 plus
another
the 13.
Right.
Almost 40. So that's what I'm talking about. And And the aquatics is just another option under the park and rec.
Well, now you can, that's not all of it, right? Because you have some trails and some other park improvements. That's in the 39 million, okay.
That's in the 39.
You could also pull out your rec facility from those improvements. You could vote specifically, you know, you have two park and rec positions, one for your other stuff, and one if you wanted to isolate the rec facility, that's what you.
I don't think that was the deal. It's just the aquatic part. That's all the really concern is right now.
And I mean, I think I'm kind of back to my same options, which are either vote it all together for $52 or $40 million and just put it out there. Or if you feel it's important to vote it separately for some reason, which you would know better than me, then vote a parks and rec proposition and then vote an indoor aquatic facility proposition. And, you know, if the park and rec doesn't pass, then just don't build your aquatic. I mean, and I don't have a problem if you want to tell the, you know, the citizens, we don't currently plan to build the aquatic. Now, you can say something without legally binding yourself. You can say, it's not currently planned that we would ever build the aquatic center if the park and rec proposition doesn't pass.
I think the legal and the practical deal are two different things. The legal deal, you wouldn't have to do it on the roads that are, or the streets that are being talked about. It just has to be done on the streets, right?
Correct.
We're just talking about a bond program.
Correct.
But if we went out and we're selling this thing on, that we're gonna do A Street, B Street, C Street, and then those three don't get done, that's what people go, you lied to us. That's what I don't wanna make the lie out front. If you want the aquatic facility as a part of the park and rec, you need to vote it here. But if you aren't gonna vote for the park and rec, it's not an option.
We can really do that, I think what Julie's saying, through the education side of it. And actually,
yes.
I think the cleanest thing is to have it two separate items on your ballot.
Okay.
But you're not suggesting that you can make, you're saying that you don't feel like you can make the aquatic facility words using a phrase similar to contingent upon the construction of.
I'm saying I think it's possible, and if that's what you want to do, I will talk to the AG about whether or not they will let us do that.
I'd like to at least have that conversation.
I think that's very straightforward.
Sure.
Way to approach this is contingent upon
one-story fire department or a two-story fire department.
And I would envision it to look something on the lines of constructing and equipping an indoor water and aquatic center, you know, and levying a tax and payment thereof, this proposition only to be effective upon the passage of Proposition 2 or whatever it is. And that's how I would pitch it to the Attorney General. And tell them that I think you should be able to do it because you can always vote it and not issue it if you don't want to. And if they're okay with that, you can vote it that way. But now that would bind you, so.
Yeah, I think we need that or lump it all together, but I don't know what the council would do or anything. I don't know where it is right now. But there are the questions that come up with the location related to the other facilities. And just looking at the Memorial Park Rec Center and the Senior Center, compared to the other ones we looked at, let's just say they looked institutional. And that's being very polite about it. Somebody could also say it looked like a penitentiary.
Someone could say that.
Okay, I didn't say that. I said somebody could have. But it that's why we just need to, if we're going to, we want to build the rec center, whatever we're calling it, the activity center and a rec center, and then the pool would be an additional deal, or the indoor water would be an additional thing if the voters approved it.
We have a guesstimate on the M&O impact.
No, I can have that for you. I just don't have it tonight. Bob, I'd have to really step back and look at it. You know, there's been some changes related to healthcare reform and what that would require. So I just really want to step back and look at it.
And until we get into the design, it's only going to be yes.
I could go to Grapevines, and that would probably get us pretty close. But again, I don't know how specifically their salaries.
Because I got to absorb that M&O cost. I mean. That's going to be significantly different than just upgrading our current center.
Absolutely.
Why don't we wait to get all that stuff for the next meeting or whenever we, if we need to have a special meeting? Don't want to, but if we need to. Let's get Leroy's, you got any comments or opinions about this?
Well, basically, I feel that it should be busted in, broken into two phases. The pool separate from the other construction and what they're trying to do. I feel that reason for a couple of reasons. One, the proximity, as Councilman Gilmore stated, to water that we already have. Mm-hmm. The unknown cost of an indoor facility kind of troubles me. And also, I feel as though we're going at the citizens with other increases in costs, water and sewer, this bond package and so forth. And I don't think that at this time we should, I don't think it's actually the right thing to do to, it gets confusing. Just listening at you try to explain it here, I think for the average person going in to the voting booth, I would rather see the issue just plain, clean, and explained.
Okay.
Not either you do this or you don't do that. And so that's my reason that I would probably be not in favor of it.
Okay, quite important.
As part of this package.
If we can, can we put the aquatic part to the side right now and just talk about the park and rec part?
Okay.
Is there any negative feelings about that or any problems on that side?
And I feel very positive. I was worried that the original plans called for it on the new property, and I was not for that at all.
I agree with you on that.
The way we landed out, I'm very happy with the plans that we have.
And that takes it more of the nature part, the way Bob is talking about it. It has some activity there, but it's not soccer fields and baseball fields and all parking lot, half parking lot.
It uses that land for the very reason it was very attractive to acquire in the first place.
Yes. Yes.
Instead of wiping that off the map, which you can go do someplace else.
Okay.
I have no problem with that part of it.
Okay, what about the other parts, the public safety in the streets? Anything to that?
No.
So we're down to the aquatic center still, so.
Yeah.
Okay. And if the bond council can come up with some wording that the attorney general agrees with, and we're not gonna go out and do our own thing out there. Whatever you recommend is what we would go with. Because the options are, the other ones are just to put it all in one deal, don't do it at all, or separate it out. That's the three things that could go with that.
Can I ask a clarifying question? So when we talk about two separate phases, are we talking about it not being a part of this election at all, it being a future election, or are we talking about it being listed separately?
For the aquatic part?
Yes.
I don't think there's a consensus right now.
I think that's a TBD.
Yeah.
Well, I don't see us voting on it now if we're going to put it off. If we're going to vote on it and it's approved, but somehow the bond council comes back with the proper language that says we're going to vote it, but we're not going to build it, I don't see where it's really appropriate for us to vote on that at when some future date, at whatever figure we're going to be dealing with in 2015, is not going to be realistic in 2018 or whenever they decide to do it.
It's going to be a separate election, a future bond election.
I mean, that's my thought on it.
I'm not saying that.
You're not.
That's my thought on it.
Right. Yeah. I'm saying that it would be two different layers. If people wanted it, it can be done. That's what I'm talking about.
Well, yeah, if the bond committee comes back and says
I don't think it would be the bond committee.
I don't mean the bond committee.
Yeah. Bond council.
Bond council comes back and decides that we're going to roll it all into one. Then that's a kind of a different issue.
Was that one of the options you had?
The dollar amount.
You didn't have it all into one. Or you could, but
You could. No, my understanding is the question that you want from the AG is, can we have two propositions contingent on each other?
Yeah.
That one happens if the other one passes. Otherwise, you know your options, which is you put them all together in one and vote the whole you know, 40 whatever million.
Right.
Yeah.
Or you put them in separate and you vote them separately and see what happens, and then you just, if the park and rec doesn't pass, then you don't build the aquatic.
Right.
All right. And you can tell people, you know, you can tell them that you're not going to do that. But I'm the main question for the AG is answering the contingent language question.
Okay.
Which is just a clarification for voters.
Right. Yeah. I think that's the whole deal.
Those are the two options. To me, it's the contingent. If we can put it in language that's the contingency type language for the voters, or not have it. Those are my two.
Okay.
Not have the water park section.
Can
go
I
with the 1.47, or I think is what that.
I'd like to make an additional comment.
1.8 or 1.4, right?
Yeah.
But the
yeah,
water adds.
Right. What adds the other 4 cents or 4/10 of a cent? Yeah.
I'm looking at this also, too, from a rollout and operational standpoint. If we do both of them together, I guarantee Parks and Rec is going to be so consumed with the water feature. I mean, I actually think it might be better to open it up, run it for 3 or 4 years, come back with another bond election to do it later and actually run it and run it properly. But I think it would be a nightmare trying to do it all at once.
And it lowers your overall cost of your bond.
Sure.
To divide it into two separate directions.
But the whole deal is that I think I'm hearing that we want the people to be able to vote on it. And if they decide not to do it and vote against the water deal, that doesn't happen. If they decide to vote against the park deal and everything else, that doesn't happen either.
I only want to see the water on there if it's the contingency model. If it's
okay.
An A and a B, and they pass B, but they don't pass, I don't want any of that. I don't want any of that. I don't want to get $20 million for a water park and then say we're not going to build it.
I'm not going to be involved in anything that says we're not going to build it. Because I hate that on roads.
Yeah, and I don't want
to. The only time you need to do that if we already built one somewhere else.
Yeah, and I don't want to be in a situation where we've got the bond money and we don't build it, and I don't want to be in a situation where we build just a water park. I worry that somebody's going to look at this thing and say, $40 million for all of this or $20 million for a water park. Well, you know what? We'll just do the water park. And I think that's going to undercut.
I agree that. That's what the problem
that's what
I
I'm
have.
Worried about.
That's the problem I have with it.
And
we'll see what they can come up
so
with.
So, yeah, I'm looking either at the contingency or no water. Those are my two preferred. Either we do the contingency model or we just don't
Let's
have the water
park. Let's see what we can come up
round.
With. Is Ray okay with that right now? See what she can come
sure.
up with?
Yeah.
Okay.
I want to
talk about the water feature versus all the parks.
That's cool.
And basically, there was no objection to the rec center being done. Right? And did everybody agree with that? That was all in the streets and the public safety deal. No issues there.
Water feature in the rec center.
Yeah, and the bond council is going to come back and see if they can either be tied together or not tied together, and what different wording would have to be.
What was the difference in the cost? 12 million?
13.
13.
Right there at the bottom. 39.9 plus 13.
I guess the other statement is that you could come back in a later bond election and decide to add the water another day altogether.
Totally separate things, a totally separate election.
But at least plan to be at the same
another
place.
Next bond election, which would be
10.
That's where we're at right now. Anybody have anything else to add? Greg?
Good stuff.
So, I guess not. That'd be best.
Good stuff.
Can we move on? What else do you have?
That's all I had.
Okay. Can we go into the regular agenda? And then, if we have time, come back to this if anybody has anything they want to bring up. So let's just go to the regular agenda. Public hearing, item number one. Okay. Item number two, another public hearing. CDBG. Consent agenda items. Number three, minutes. Number four, approval of resolution.
I believe we're going to have to table this, Mayor. We listed just one agency, and there's a number of agencies that are involved here, so we're going to have to bring that to you back to you.
On number four?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
So one of us will need to pull that.
You got that, TJ?
One of us need to pull that?
Yes.
Okay, I can pull that.
Okay. Item number five. Item number six. Item seven. Okay. Regular hearings, item eight.
I've got a question on this one here. The way it's stated right now, I mean, basically there would be no grandfathering in. Is there a way to do this that we could grandfather in the existing businesses?
We allow it. Or it's just that wasn't the direction we had at the time, so.
The reason I say that, I mean, I've talked with businesses today that, you know, just a week ago put up $1,800 worth of lights. You know, you're talking several hundred dollars more to patch it, repair it, and take it all down. I don't know that I feel good about doing that to an existing business, costing them several thousand dollars to put this up, and we immediately ban it.
Could do that.
I can't support it without that provision.
What about a different timeline?
A timeline of years versus, what is it, 90 days, I believe?
90 days.
I mean, if there were multiple years involved with it, I might be able to.
Put a number out there.
5 years?
Considering the cost you just threw out there, I think that's long. I could go two, maybe three, to amortize that cost. People spend that more than that in a year in advertising budgets.
3 years? I could go with 3 years.
I could do that.
If y'all were going to bring something, could y'all do that tonight, or you need to bring it back?
And you can make a verbal amendment on the diet.
It's the way we make the motion.
Okay.
So would you be changing the effective date to go immediately and then just grandfather or existing for 3 years, or would you do 90 days and then allow anyone who puts in lights within those 90 days to then be grandfathered?
No, I do it immediately and grandfather for 3 years.
Exactly. Right. It's just in the form of the motion. We can, and I can change the ordinance.
Okay. Any other?
Yeah, I'm going to be not in favor. I have heartburn with this.
Yeah.
This is playing whack-a-mole. And I'm sorry,
but
it's playing whack-a-mole. The technology changes every 6 months. We're going to, you know what? We'll do it here. Where is that?
That
might be easier.
It's like
a
ball.
Center time. Like we said,
it
worked.
Just got consensus.
There we go. So, I had the opportunity to drive around last night because I couldn't sleep because I was dealing with this. So I drove down and I thought, where is the worst place I could go? What is the absolute worst example of this? And so I went to Harry Heinz with my wife and my mother.
Okay.
Good times, really good times. But I'm thinking about all the different types of advertising marketing that I just hate, okay? So we all, the Sarah's Secret billboards, which we wish she would keep secret. You know, they're obnoxious, they're horrible. But roaches on the ABC sign on the freeway, you know, by the way, that ABC sign is white. It's so much brighter than the digital billboard behind it. It's ridiculous. So I've got roaches crawling up this thing. You know which one bugs me a ton going down to Dallas is going down and seeing the Old Warsaw Steakhouse. Has anybody seen that billboard? It is a beautiful woman and a filet steak, and it's like clip art on a white background. They don't even match. Right? So there's all these marketing things out there that suck. And these things suck, by the way. These lights, just, they're miserable. So this is the 3D smoke shop up on 407. This is Stanley Karaoke down at Harry Heinz. And guess what? You know, they've got the lighting going on there, but they've taken that same rope lighting and they've outlined their sign. And by the way, that's the Quick Mart down on 121. They have the exact same rope lighting outlining their sign.
But this ordinance doesn't touch that.
I understand that. And that's the silliness of this is that we're banning rope lighting in a specific certain way. Well, what about this guy? You know, he's got stationary videos. I mean, is this outlining a window or not? I mean, because I've got an 80-inch screen and it's all black and it's square just like my window, is the inlet, is it being outlined or not? And how far back inside the building does he need to be? So, and of course this was, you know, he had rope lighting and he had blinking lights and all of this stuff. And all of this, I can get an 80-inch television for $2,000. So, you know, we go down and, you know, as we're driving, I realized that what was the most obnoxious about all of this was really, it was the brightness is what created the obnoxious. I really didn't have a problem with a lot of these. I mean, that looks nice. It's the exact same lighting as this store. Exactly the same rope lighting. Looks nice there. And this one, this was like Tron. I want this in Louisville. This was awesome. I mean, these lights changed colors, they blinked, they chased each other around. It was awesome. It was every 80s kid's dream of a bedroom was that one. And it was cool, because it was just ridiculously over the top. But was it annoying? Yeah. It wasn't the greatest. All right, so when we look at these things, let's see here. You know, here's backlighting. This stuff, this is like an LSD trip. This building was being lit up, and there was no rhyme or reason to the colors. You know, how about this guy? The Anchor Motel, anybody been there? That's all LED lighting. It actually looks kind of cool. Yeah, be careful. Now, my wife took this one as we were driving up 35. You guys know what that one is? La Hacienda. Been there for decades. Guess what? Their ordinance in our neighbor town that bans the rope lights doesn't ban this. And keep going with those. So, there's our Quick Mart and our Taco Hut, and you know, LED versus but you know, if it was neon, it'd be fine, right? And I've seen lots of Chinese restaurants. We just don't happen to have one in Louisville where they outline a neon. Would that be bad? Would we ban neon? I don't know.
We're not banning this.
Well,
why neon? Why would neon?
How about this guy? That sign's a whole lot brighter than this little guy. What's the irritation? I don't know. This guy, Monterey Grill, this guy was awesome. Okay, this is down on 121. These lights are set on the inside of the window, and they face towards each other instead of out. So they're kind of dull, but they rotate. So he's got red, and then green, and then yellow. It was really hard to get this photo. And then, of course, Priscilla McCall's with the half-dressed statuary in the front. Maybe more offensive than the lighting, I don't know.
So the only one in this picture addressed is Boost Mobile.
Sure. And if you want to get picky about individuals and those types of things, we can. Well, here's one that's not even covered. I didn't even doctor this, guys. That's not even covered by the new or the old ordinance. Those are yard lights. Right in the parking lot. My point of all of this is it is not about the road lights to me. It is about the actual lumens at the facility. Let's just make an objective standard like our noise ordinance. Make it simple. How many lumens per whatever that square footage is? And there are tons of model ordinances out there. Tucson's been doing this since the 70s.
Don't we already have that?
We don't have a lumen requirement.
For gas stations. Don't we have it for gas stations?
I don't believe so.
I tried to make it part of the discussion when we were talking about the road lighting previously.
Yep.
We have a light trespass ordinance.
Isn't that what we're talking about here?
That's
the lumens?
To my point, how bright is the total amount of lights that you have coming off of your building?
Right.
And if it's in rope light form, if it's in spotlight form, I didn't even get a picture of the one with the rotating LED lights and the strobe light on the bar. It was impressive. I mean, it was seizure inducing. To me, guys, it's a mistake to get into this nitpicking and whack-a-mole, because what happens when we start doing LEDs that are battery-powered and they're just little stick-ons? Or we start doing flat screens, or next week we have some sort of new window tint that's LEDs and it just sticks on the windows. You know, and that's just 2 hours of driving around. I think the concept of what we're trying to do makes sense. We want to reduce the light pollution. Let's do that. Let's make it a lumens piece. They can decorate however they want, whether I like it or not. Because right now, I feel like we're legislating what I like. And I saw a lot of signs I didn't like that sucked, but that's just me. I'm not here to legislate what people like and don't like. I'm here to figure out if we can create an objective standard.
Do you like the look of North Harry Hines?
There were things that I thought were really cool. There were things that you don't like.
Outside, did you like the look of North Harry Hines?
You know, this part of North Harry Hines?
I'm talking about this part. Did you like the look of North Harry Hines? That's the question on the table.
Did I like the look of North Harry Hines?
Is that the business model you want to attract?
That's an interesting way to put it.
That's the question.
Sure. I like components of Harry Hines.
That's not the answer.
Well, that's fine. You can pin me into a corner if you like, but there's, again, we're getting into judgment calls. Why not just have an objective standard on lights? It's simple. It's just like the sign ordinance.
Why not answer my question? Did you like the look of North Harry Hines? Is that the business model you wish to attract?
If it's that kind of a business area, I don't have an issue with it. I don't. We have it on 121.
So you like having what we have on 121?
I don't like it, but I don't think the lights are the issue.
Do you think that they contribute to attracting a better quality of business?
I don't think they detract. I don't think they do anything other than point out that this is a donut shop or an e-cig shop or a gas station, because those are 90% of who use it. I don't. I think it's fad.
And that's 90% of the type of business you're going to attract.
We have it already. It's not attracting anymore. It's going to attract what it attracts. It's economics.
It's going to set up the standard for that shopping area to say, this is the quality of business that belongs here. Bring more light.
Then reduce the lumen count.
So as far as that lumen count is, is it possible to get something like that and to measure it easily, yes. Realistically?
Yes, absolutely. In fact, the conversation.
Do we do that currently with noise? We do that with noise. Items that can measure?
That is correct. The green code that we've been involved in looking at would actually do that to an extent, and we'll be bringing that to you sometime after January. No cities in Texas have really adopted the green code, but some elements of the green code could get to what TJ is talking
about. Does anybody have any expertise here to know, let's say that one of these shops has LED lights up now, and they don't make the lumens. Is there something you can do to put a dimmer and dial it down, or is it going to have to be just scrapped and started?
Most of them come equipped with them now.
That's what I'm asking. Do they?
Just doing the research, most of them that you buy now, they come pre-equipped with a dimmer. In fact, the white ones that you see can be multicolored.
Because in my driving around, there was some, like, by the Drunken Donkey, that donut place is so bright. I would be mad if I was the business next door because you can't see my business now because of this business.
Well, and like, go up to Landmark Grill. They've got them. You don't even notice them. You don't notice Landmark Grill. They're a little off the road. They use dimmer red ones. You just don't see them.
If there's an interest in that, we want to spend some time looking at the options and bring back a revised room.
Well, that's what I expressed in our last conversation about this, and you stated that you were going to, it would be brought up at a later time. Is that what you're saying?
Absolutely.
If I could figure out a way to put a moratorium on new ones between now and then that'd be a great way to split the baby.
I don't think there is an easy way to get to a moratorium.
Neil's point was he was trying to stop any further expansion of this practice?
Yes, they're like bandit signs. Trust me, if you put one out, you'll get five more.
And they'll just move
if you
to
leave
diagonal
them there, you'll
lines.
Get 20 more.
They'll move to, out instead of outlining the window, they'll put diagonal lines in the window, they'll set them further back in the building, they'll go to an LED board. I mean, we can play whack-a-mole all day long. The issue was, when they're bright, they offend you. And you can play the game whack-a-mole. It's a little
ball.
It's a game like at the it's like a skee ball game. You smack the mole when it pops up.
Okay,
that's all. Just a comment. That's all speculation, but that's not what has happened in other cities that have gone forward with this. So, even though it's speculation, it's not proving to be fact.
And how many other cities? There's one.
In our survey, Carrollton was the only city.
Okay, the only one in our survey. Not that it's the only one in Texas.
So like in Flower Mound, they can do this now in Flower Mound with no?
No.
No.
Flower Mound's sign ordinance is tightened down to, unless of course you have a big neon sign or Jake's Burgers, then apparently you can get an exemption.
Okay, let's move to the next item. Anything we need to follow up on this?
Are we deciding how we're going to handle it? I heard from Councilman Daniels that he wanted a moratorium.
No, he wanted a grandfather.
I said grandfather, and we had talked about 3 years, which I would be acceptable with that.
You have to do all that in a motion on the dais.
You know, and if you want to do that, that's fine. I just don't want the lumen thing to die because we're done with it.
I don't think the lumen thing was going to die. It was an instruction from Councilman Vaughn going forward. The city manager said that they would work on that.
Sometime after the first year, is that what you said? Okay.
So you were saying you're opposed to this ordinance?
If I can get a guarantee that we're going to deal with lumens, which is the root issue.
I supported it. You brought it up. I was for it.
It's going to come up.
All I got was an ordinance back. I didn't get a we're going to follow up.
No. The only guarantee you got now is that you're going to get, it's going to be presented to look at. No guarantees after that.
That's fair.
Okay. Well, let's go to number 9 and finish this.
I just
stated, you know,
previously it was going to be brought back.
I did not seem clear to me on
okay.
that.
Okay.
Okay. Number 9, Leela. Number 10, wastewater main extension. 11. Signal.
Mayor, one question you had asked earlier was on the population. We can do this for cities that are less than 50,000, and by census, the colony is not 50,000, so when they do get that by census, then this service will work.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you. 12. It's the newspaper. Unsubscribe. 13. Geo bond program. And what do y'all need on this, other than what we've talked about already?
Well, I just need a direction on what to bring back to you on the 17th. And what I've heard, I need to bring back are two options.
Aquatic park.
The Attorney General's office and get direction, so I'm going to bring back two ordinances as well.
So does this actually require any motion?
Yeah, you can just give her direction.
Have we done that in this public forum?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so.
Occasionally. And sometimes you do make a motion and give in your direction and vote on it, and sometimes you just give her direction.
This is one I want to be very clear on.
What would your advice be?
Well, it sounds like she'd like a motion.
Okay.
Okay. I'll do it.
Okay. That's it. We're in a closed session. Okay. Got about 7 minutes and we'll start up after. Any other comments or questions right now? On the bond program, we still can go back to that if anybody has anything on that. I think we beat it to death already.
I think we got that.
So, and council is already gone? She already gone?
Yes, yeah, she has.
Okay. So don't bring it up anymore. Mayor Pro Tem Ferguson.
Please stand and join me in a moment of silent prayer.
Please join me in the pledges to the United States and Texas flags. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with
liberty, and justice for all. Honor the Texas flag. I pledge allegiance to thee, Texas, one state under God, one and indivisible.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mayor and Council. We're here tonight to give a life-saving award. I'd like to ask Detention Officers William O'Hare and Arnulfo Rios to please join me down front. You know, everybody, when you think about a police department, you think about the uniformed guys that maybe stop you for a traffic citation or something like that. And it appears to be the most visible face of a police department in most communities. A lot of unsung heroes, though, that do some thankless work for us. One of those jobs is the detention officer position in our city jail. So I just want to recognize these gentlemen for a life-saving award. If you'll bear with me, I'll read the citation. On May 16, 2015, detention officers William O'Hare and Arnulfo Rios saved an inmate who attempted suicide. The police department's award committee met to review this incident and recommended detention officers O'Hare and Rios receive a life-saving award. If not for their quick response and immediate actions, this individual would have most likely died. On behalf of the City of Louisville and the Louisville Police Department, it is with great pride that I present both of you with a life-saving award. The actual award. And I know these gentlemen are just like anybody else at the police department. They couldn't do what they do every day without the support that they have from home. So I'm going to give them a chance to talk to, you know, introduce anybody in the audience that they have.
The worst thing is to put me in front of a microphone. I do need to thank my family. They put up with this for quite a few years. I started as a police officer back when the Dead Sea was just sick in 1977. I retired in February of 2014, and my wife allowed me to go back to work yet again. So my wife, Joanne, my daughter-in-law, Lindsay, and my son, Tim, who is carrying on the family business. Thanks for putting up with me for all these years. Appreciate it.
I just want to thank my aunt and her daughter, Hope Cardona and Elisa, for showing up, and a longtime friend of the family, Wanda. It means a lot for y'all to come here. I just hit my one-year anniversary with Louisville, and I'm looking forward to working at least 19 more. Thank you.
Next item of business is a public hearing. This is an ordinance granting a special use permit for a gas station on 1.109 acres located at the southwest corner of Plano Parkway and Tittle Drive. Comments that the gas station will be 100% stone exterior with landscaping, which exceeds the minimum requirements. Monument sign will be used in lieu of a pole sign. P&Z recommended unanimous approval of the SUP at their meeting on July 7th, 2015. Recommendation is that City Council approve the proposed ordinance as set forth in the caption. And we have Coffee Addo available for questions. Anybody else wish to speak? Councilman Daniels, do you have a motion to close the public hearing?
Make a motion to close public hearing.
Second.
We have a second by Councilman Vaughn. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, say nay. Motion carries. Councilman Daniel.
Make a motion to approve.
Second.
Have a motion to approve by Councilman Daniel and a second by Councilman Ferguson. Councilor?
There's no discussion. This is an ordinance of the City Council of the City of Lewisville, Texas, amending the zoning ordinance of the City of Lewisville, Texas, by granting a special use permit for a gasoline service station on approximately 1.019 acre tract of land, legally described as a portion of Lot 3, Block B, Austin Ranch West, located on the southwest corner of Plano Parkway and Tittle Drive and Zone Light Industrial District, providing for severability, providing a penalty, providing a repealer, providing an effective date, and declaring an emergency.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, say nay. Motion carries unanimously. Item 2, public hearing. This is a resolution authorizing the adoption of CDBG 2015 Annual Action Plan. Comments. An annual action plan must be submitted to HUD by August 16th as a requirement to receive CDBG funds of $616,796 in fiscal year 2015-16. At their June 16th, 2015 meeting, the CDBG Advisory Committee unanimously recommended a draft budget of $170,000, which has been incorporated into the action plan. Recommendation is that the City Council approve the resolution as set forth in the caption above. I don't have anybody to speak on this. Okay. Councilman Tierney, do you have a move to close?
We have second.
Motion to close, second by Councilman TJ. Any discussion? Greg, do you have anything on this? Do we have to motion to approve?
Well, you need a vote on the motion to close.
Right. Okay, we have a motion to approve. Is there a second?
Wait, Mayor, we need a vote on the motion to close.
Vote on the close.
Do what?
Vote on the close.
Vote on the motion to close.
Okay, motion to close. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, say nay. Motion carries. Councilman Tierney.
Move to approve.
Second.
We have a motion to approve by Councilman Tierney, second by T.J. Gilmore.
You just go to a vote.
Okay. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, say nay. Motion carries unanimously. Okay. Next item is Visitor Citizens Forum. At this time, any person with business before the City Council not scheduled on the agenda may speak to the Council. No formal action can be taken on these items at this meeting. I do have one card filled out for Jonathan Hightower. Yeah, Mr. Hightower, if you can give us your name and address for the record.
Certainly, thank you. Can you hear me okay? All right, my name is Jonathan Hightower. I live at 1485 Juniper Lane here in Lewisville. And I'm here to speak tonight because it seems like we've got a little bit of a problem with how resources are being allocated to ordinance modification and development. You may remember a couple years ago, it took over a year to get the ordinance passed just to make it illegal for people to keep dogs locked up in their cars while they went to the store with the windows up. Pretty clear safety issue. It took close to a year to get our current chicken ordinance passed. And in the time, close to 2 years since the chicken ordinance was passed, we've been trying to get it revised as we knew would need to happen when it was passed. Several of us have been back over time and have spoken at City Council meetings and have reached out to individual City Council members because the current chicken ordinance eliminates many of the benefits of having hens. It's written in a way that blocks over 60% of the city's population from having hens just with the lot size limitation. Our goals are to eliminate that lot size limitation, to eliminate the setback requirement aside from what's normal for an accessory building, and to eliminate the requirement for chickens to be penned or cooped up in a small area. I think we can all agree that dogs are more likely to be a nuisance animal in terms of feces and noise. Nobody's ever going to propose limiting dogs to a small kennel enclosed in a yard or chaining them in a backyard so that they can't go close to a neighbor's house. In fact, I think we may have an ordinance saying you can't do that. These three changes are simple. They're in line with the existing ordinances restricting every other domestic animal, and they're in line with what most of our neighboring cities do. Despite formal requests from us to the city here, nothing has happened over a period of many months. And yet, only a month ago, this LED light bar issue was brought up, and we already have a proposed ordinance. As city business goes, that's blazingly fast. I checked with the Louisville staff on Facebook this morning and was told that this was developed despite no one making any formal complaints or reaching out to the city asking for this to happen. So we've come multiple times to present our case, one that no one's even made any arguments against, and we get ignored, but an aesthetic issue that nobody has asked to have changed has been fast-tracked. That's backwards. It's not how things are supposed to be. I had emailed Councilman Ferguson about 9 months ago about the chicken ordinance, and he replied from his city account, copied in the city manager. He's got a few words to keep in mind as we go into the LED discussion later. I know it may be a little lengthy. Quote, to consider adding any new item at this time or for the foreseeable future, the item must have either a multi-million dollar impact, positive or negative, identifiable impact on a significant percentage of the city's population, more than 5 to 10%, present a confirmed threat to life or health, present crucial grandfathering timeline issues, have a timeline-sensitive component that makes action now or never with serious consequences, or ideally, two or more of the above. The items already in the queue, even when limited to those that cannot be postponed, have city staff push beyond their capacity for quite some time to come. End quote. If this is changed, then I think we can look forward to seeing a properly revised chicken ordinance presented in the next couple of council meetings. If not, then maybe this LED light bar ordinance is not the best use of city resources.
Mayor, he needs to keep his comments.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. I don't have any other cards to speak on this. Next item is consent agenda. All of the following items on the consent agenda are considered to be self-explanatory by the council and will be enacted with one motion. There will be no separate discussion of these items unless a council member or citizen so requests. For a citizen to request removal of an item, a speaker card must be filled out and submitted to the city secretary.
Mayor,
I don't have any cards.
Pull item four.
Okay. Pull item number four.
Move to approve the consent agenda with the exclusion of item four.
Okay.
Second.
Okay. Councilman Gilmore and a second by, is that? Okay. Councilman Tierney. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, say nay. Motion carries unanimously. Okay, item number four is approval of a resolution authorizing the city social service agency fund agreement between the city of Louisville and communities and schools and authorization for city officials to execute the agreement.
Yeah.
Mayor, if I can stop you, I believe city staff would like to pull this item so no action is necessary.
Do what?
City staff would like to pull this item, and so no action is necessary. We can just move on to
okay, you don't have to read it or anything? No motion? Done? Okay. Okay. That item number four has been pulled. Okay. Now we're down to G, regular hearings. Item number eight. This is an ordinance adding regulations related to LED or other continuous or connected series of lights. Administrative comments. In accordance with the direction given to staff by the council at the July 6, 2015 workshop, the proposed ordinance regulates the use of LED and other continuous or connected series of lights similar to the city of Carrollton, but allows the use of these types of lighting for outdoor patios, trees, light poles, and other similar appurtenances. Recommendation is that City Council approve the proposed ordinance as set forth in the caption above. Councilman Ferguson.
Move to approve as presented with the modification that there would be a grandfathering period for any installation in place and operable today of a period of 3 years, and the ordinance takes effect immediately.
Okay, we have a motion. Is there a second?
Second.
Okay, second by Councilman Daniels. Any discussion?
Mayor, I do have a couple quick questions. The idea was brought up earlier in the workshop session as far as a moratorium. tell me what that would take to have a moratorium on this.
Well,
if this were not to move forward tonight,
how would we be able to go about?
The local government code sets forth the requirements for moratoriums, so we would have to identify a threat to public health, safety, or welfare to institute a moratorium. So we would need time to identify that. We couldn't do it tonight.
I understand that, but it's possible.
Well, if I could take y'all into closed session to discuss it, I'd be happy to.
All right, this is my thinking. We're going to be bringing up the lumens at the beginning of the year.
Correct.
And as I understand it, and I agree with this, the lumens could and probably the control of the lumens could and probably will control the light pollution that we're dealing with. So if we're going to be dealing with that at the beginning of the year, I have a little bit of a problem putting these specific restrictions in place now if the problem that I see is going to be handled in January. So if we can handle it in January, have something in place to where we don't get any more of these, a bunch of these more installed between now and then, that's kind of what I'm thinking.
Certainly we can bring back the issue in January related to the lumens, but the moratorium issue certainly might have some challenges putting something like that in place, and the city attorney could probably better advise you on that. But you could have rope lighting that could be added to various businesses in the next few weeks. So we would need to look at the moratorium concept fairly quickly to limit it as you are proposing.
Mayor,
if I can.
Can we break out into executive session?
I want to give the public a right to speak here on this first. I forgot to do this before, and I apologize to the four people. First item is first person to speak on this, Bob Marion. Okay, Mr. Marion, if you can give us your name and address for the record, please.
Bob Marion, 1316 Falcon Drive, Louisville, 75077.
Okay.
Go ahead. Good afternoon. First, I'd like to thank the City Council for the great job all of you do. 3 or 4 weeks ago, I read about the LED light ordinance in the Louisville Texan and the Louisville Facebook page. My first thought was, doesn't the City Council have anything better to do? And then over the last 3 or 4 weeks, I started driving around, and I started noticing at convenience stores, smoke shops, dry cleaners, alteration shops, all of these LED lights, and they were just blinding, and then a thought hit me. 6 months down the road, what is this city going to be like? I think we'll be like Shreveport. We will be called West Shreveport. If we don't take action now and we don't be direct and stop the proliferation of these LED lights. So I ask you this, do we want to be known as West Shreveport? I say no. So I'm asking you to eliminate the LED lights in Louisville for safety reasons, for aesthetic reasons, and to move the city forward to 2025.
Okay, thank you, sir. Next person to speak on this, John Garina. John, if you can give us your name and address for the record, please.
Thank you, Mayor. John Garina, 417 Creekwood Lane, Louisville, Texas, 75067. Just want to tell you up front, I'm against this ordinance. Probably not for all the reasons you guys come up with, but I want to say a few things of what I've been hearing about what's online from the workshop meeting July 6th and what I've been reading and past previous discussions about such types of things about signs when I was on the council. What this comes down to, I'm against it, what it comes down to is a personal like and dislike. You're either for business rights or you're not for business rights. Okay, this, what it comes down to is, I'm starting to feel like all of y'all don't have liberty and freedom in your DNA. Now, there are some lights I don't like. There are some businesses that I don't like, but I don't own that business. I didn't take out my personal money and make that business. Some of you are business owners. You know exactly what I'm talking about. If I don't like a light, it's me. If we make this room completely dark, this little red light on here is going to be blinding, right? You know, over time, you know, cave creatures, you know, you heard about all that. But when you look at lights out there and you're talking about lumens, you're talking about a relative thing. You go to, the only thing I didn't hear was QT. QT is a great, you know, quick stop, you know, get gas, whatever. But it's all lit up around it. It's got lights and it's got everything because that's relative. If I turned off all those big bright white lights and I just put on the, you know, rope lighting or whatever they have around there, then yeah, that would stick out. But that's what I'm hearing here. I don't like that light. I don't like this. I don't like that. It doesn't matter. Liberty and freedom means that you need to allow people to do things that are legal, and even though you don't like it, they're not hurting anybody. And when it, and what you're doing is you're just making a law against it to make it illegal. So one of the funniest terms I've heard in this whole discussion is light pollution. Now, what is light pollution? That's that light that reflects off the atmosphere or in the, that is too bright because I don't get to see the stars or whatever I heard. We're in the city. And the light pollution, it's the funniest term I've ever heard. The light pollution that Dallas puts off is pretty bright. The highway that we have going through here with all the headlights puts off light pollution. Last time I'm going to use that silly term. You guys talked about types of businesses, and I agree with Mr. Gilmore's concept of playing whack-a-mole. You start putting these restrictions, people are going to find ways around it. They're going to either, you had some great examples, sir. You talked about within the building, they're going to have TVs a little brighter in the background. When do we, where does it stop? Carrollton, you mentioned that Carrollton has a similar type ordinance regulating some type of lights. Out of our 14 survey cities, one. I think Carrollton's on the wrong end of this. You know, we have, you know, we have our government tell us what kind of light bulbs we buy. So we buy the light bulbs, LED lights, whatever. We want to light up our store the way we like it. I believe some of them look really gaudy. I don't like them either. But that's what that store owner wanted. That was his or her money. That is what their clientele wants. It comes down to liberty and freedom. If you don't like the if you don't like the lights, don't go there. Okay? It just they have rights. And thank you for listening to me. So either for it or against it. Not little. Well, let's wait 2 months or put a moratorium on it or wait. Does it matter how many lights you don't like or do like? That's where I'm at. Thank you.
Thank you, John. Next up, Jack Avalon. Jack, if you can give us your name and address for the record, please.
Jack Avalon, 2197 South Euchre Lane, 75067.
Okay, go ahead.
Good evening, Mayor and Council. This ordinance is about, according to Mr. Guerina, business rights. Well, what he's contending is business privileges. Right now, these lights are a fad. And as soon as everybody has them, then we have to have a new fad to attract business because everybody's got them. So now it's not effective, if it's even effective at all. There are no studies that prove these lights improve business. You can have a city without business, but you can't have a city without citizens. Citizens have the right to determine the appearance of their own city. And the consensus by most people that look at these things are they're too bright. Now, I am, for one, against banning specific technology. I think that shoots yourself in the foot. It was like when the United States car industry outlawed advanced lighting from Europe. And for 30 years, we were behind in what we could have on our automobiles for lighting because we banned a specific technology rather than creating a description of what we will allow and won't allow. This could be one of those things. But until January, when you're going to address all of that, in the meantime, the fad can grow like a virus. And you can have a lot of things that then you're forced to grandfather that you don't want to grandfather. If you stop it now with at least a moratorium until you can come up with realistic regulations that will regulate by performance and appearance and specific things rather than banning a technology. That's why I support y'all doing this, because I believe it protects the look of our city and our property values. I don't want to look like Harry Hines. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Avalon. Next one up, Winston Edmondson. Good evening, Mr. Edmondson. If you can give us your name and address for the record, please.
Certainly. Winston Edmondson, 1292 Marchant Place, Lewisville, Texas. Mayor Durham, first I want to thank you for your leadership during the workshop session. It was clear that you were against this ordinance, and I think for a lot of the same reasons I am. You strike me as someone that appreciates liberty, and you did a good job of preventing the council from adding even more restrictions. Some of them were talking about nightlights. You know, at a certain time, the lights had to be turned off, so you at least prevented them from going even further with this. I appreciate that. Councilman Daniels, Councilman Gilmore, you asked very important questions during that workshop meeting. I want to thank you as well. Mr. Daniels, your experience as an entrepreneur, you have a business here in Lewisville. I think your experience is invaluable in this area, and I think that's how you were able to ask some of these questions. The answers to those questions, I think, really demonstrate why we shouldn't move forward with this. Councilman Tierney, you as well here earlier demonstrated your desire to kind of slow things down. So I want to talk about this ordinance specifically first, why I think we shouldn't move forward today. You know, we touted some really impressive numbers during the 2025 vision of citizen participation. And I truly believe that was kind of Lewisville's thing. You know, we were going to move forward as a city that wanted to always encourage participation. So I was surprised and disappointed that for this meeting, the 30 plus businesses that have these lights weren't notified. They weren't invited to speak. You know, you definitely have the right to pass this ordinance, but I would think that you would at least want to hear them out and hear what they have to say. Maybe have a conversation about what you can come to an agreement together without even having to pass an ordinance. So it was really, really surprising that you didn't have them here. I think if you do decide to pass something, you would want them here so you could sell them on it. Maybe you do have some valid reasons for wanting to do that, and I think this would be a great opportunity to sell them and get that buy-in. So, you know, the city with the 2025 vision and all the citizens that are engaged, can we please go back to encouraging that type of engagement always and get the people that are going to be affected in here? Let's get them involved or at least extend that invitation. I'm also opposed to this ordinance because of the way it's written. I don't know if it was intentional, but it doesn't specify between indoor or outdoor. So when you say you can't have a vertical LED installation going up any type of structure, it doesn't specify indoor or outdoor. So I was in T-Mobile the other day, and they have a really great-looking design that's based on LED. It looks classy. It's great indoors. But this ordinance would actually ban them because of the way it's written. You know, so I think it has those unintended consequences. That's dangerous. I think we should kind of slow down, and if you're determined to pass this ordinance, let's invite the stakeholders. You know, there are business partners here in Lewisville. They're important. Let's write it in a way where it's very precise. Right now, if you pass this ordinance, a business could do an LED installation around the window that doesn't outline it. Maybe it varies in the shape, But this ordinance specifies it, it's only disallowed if it outlines the window. So, you know, I think someone brought this up, the whack-a-mole. There's, right now, the way it's written, there's a lot of loopholes that would just allow citizens to slightly alter the way they have it, and it wouldn't make a change. So we're just adding ordinances, and then we're gonna have to go back and try to readdress what they did. That doesn't make sense. Kind of stepping back further than that, I think when you have an ordinance like this that is about an annoyance, really, there's no real safety concern. It's some citizens don't like the way it looks. Even though there are no complaints by a citizen, Councilman Ferguson complained about it, and there are citizens that don't like it. But is that reason enough to ban it completely? I don't think so. When it's not a safety issue, I think we are better suited to kind of compile these types of aesthetic issues, and once a year when we have an election, we can add that and let the citizens vote. That way, if we're actually gonna restrict a business owner, like Mr. Grana said, this is, you know, in America, we don't have the right to a job, but we always have the right to start our own business. So what you're talking about is restricting how a business owner makes their money. You say it may not be effective, maybe it's not, but for the business owner to put it up, obviously he did it for a reason. If we're gonna restrict that for no safety reason, let's at least have the citizens be the ones to do that, not a handful of citizens making design choices. I don't think that the citizens elected you guys for your design
Mr.
skills.
Edmondson, you're at your 5 minutes.
Yes, sir,
limit,
thank you, so. Appreciate it.
Thank you, sir. Okay. We've had requests to go into closed session. We will do that now. Thank you. We're now in closed session. Open session. Councilman Tierney, you want to continue your discussion?
Yeah, thank you, Mayor. And thank you for the clarification on the moratorium. Appreciate the input from the residents that spoke. Continuing with what I had started, I'm going to be opposed to this as it sits tonight. I am in support of looking at this problem in general in the future. I do disagree. I'm certainly a proponent of business rights. Now, as a city, we certainly have to put certain restrictions on how a business does their business. If I wanted to open up a business and do so in a pole barn with no running water and put up lights that are similar to the ballpark in Arlington and have half-naked women holding signs out front and 15 elephants that have signs on them and 27 other different signs, that's not what we're looking for in our city. There's certainly, I'm pro-business rights, but we have to have certain restrictions that don't make our city look trashy, don't affect neighboring businesses, neighboring residents. And I do believe that at a certain point, whether it's excessive signage, whether it's building maintenance, whether it's building construction, whether it's noise produced by the business or lighting produced by the business, there are certain restrictions that have to be in place. I think with what we're looking at doing in January, I think that will sufficiently address the issues that are brought to hand.
Okay. Any further discussion?
Yes, Mayor. I mean, one of the things that I want to say here, because we keep talking about business rights and we keep talking about businessmen. Well, I am a businessman, and one of the things that I want is when I build a business, I want the comfort and security of knowing that the city is going to protect my business, okay? I don't want to be the business next door to some of these lights, okay? And one of the things we have to understand is to attract great businesses to Louisville, we have to give them the security of certain ordinances. Just like you don't want your neighborhood that somebody has the car up on blocks, we protect that.
We don't want the business that has the car up on blocks, and in many ways, that's what these LEDs are. During 2020-2025 plan, all I heard from people was, we've got to improve the look of the city, and this is one way we can do it. So I think we need to improve the look of the city. I think we need to give assurances to the businesses that we have here now that we will protect them with smart ordinances. And I guarantee sign ordinances will adapt as technology adapts, and we've got to keep up with that. So that being said, I talked to business owners today, and one business owner I talked to had just put in $1,800, and they put it in last week. And that's where in the workshop I said I wouldn't have anything to do with this that didn't give at least some type of grandfathering. And I think the 3 years to be able to amortize that $1,800 is more than fair. But I think as council, we've got to not only think about the businesses that have them, but protect the businesses that don't.
Okay. Councilman Gilmore, do you have anything?
Sure. Tim, you've got a couple of slides up there for me. So I took a drive last night, and some of you have already heard this, so I'll try and make it a little bit briefer. So this is Louisville, 3D smoke shop. You know, it's got the rope lighting around it. And to Councilman Daniels' point, I the amortization is a nice step, and I think that's something that we could absolutely add when we address this with a lumens-based system. So we have, okay, so we've got 120 of these businesses or whatever that number happens to be between now
31.
And January. Well, between now and January, whatever we add. We can still give those folks the opportunity to amortize. So we deal with it as a hiccup. We deal with it as overtime and just amortize that this six-month window where we're trying to come up with an objective standard on lighting within this city is my take. And just, Tim, if you keep going, you know, this uses rope lights both along the roof line, which would be fine. It uses the rope lights to outline the family karaoke, which would also be fine. The only part of this particular building that wouldn't work is the vertical line or the horizontal lines. I sent six pictures to code, and they took a look at it and said what would pass and what wouldn't if we put this ordinance in. So, you know, is that still appropriate or not? I don't know. It's aesthetics. Look at how I dress. It's all because of my wife. I'm not good with aesthetics. I need an objective standard. Tim, this is the LED shop. This guy sells these things. He's got more different types of technology ready to go. When a city bans one, he's going to pop out another. And we're going to just, you know, the phrase whack-a-mole came up. For those of you who don't know, it's a kid's game. Go to Chuck E. Cheese. You'll find it. They're just going to roll out another technology, you know. Is this outlining a window? I don't know, but it's an 80-inch plasma screen sitting in there in the window. Could technically, if I just drew a little white line, it would work. Here's another one. And what my wife and I decided when we were driving around, what was really, wasn't the outlining that was irritating. It was the brightness that was irritating. We didn't even notice several of them as we're driving around. Next slide. This was a plaza done in outline. Now, the previous one, you saw it around the windows, looked horrible. Same exact lighting along the top line, look great. Next slide. This one, I said in the workshop, it looked like Tron. These lights danced around, and it's like Pac-Man chasing each other, and rainbow lights were going on. It was awesome. It's staggering the amount of technology they put on their windows. Would I want it? No, but that's my personal opinion. This one, this looked like I don't know. This looked like an LSD nightmare. This building, the lights just kept changing colors. That's not even touched in the ordinances, whether you want that or not. Next slide, Tim. This one probably wouldn't make it here in Louisville, although we do have the Pines Motel with its big neon sign. This is the Anchor Motel, and I hope to God none of you ever live there or stay there, because this was a really small environment. I don't know how they afforded this big a sign that all in LED blinking. Next slide, Tim. This one, our neighbors who banned the rope lights, this is the Hacienda on 35, blurry picture because my wife was taking it in the car, but that's not banned. The rope lights, if those were done in LED, that would be banned in our neighbor who's put this ordinance in place, but these, everybody likes these. These are the incandescent lights. They're pretty. They work great. We've all eaten at the La Hacienda, or we've driven by it on 35. So that's acceptable, but LED's not. I, you know, where's the line there? I don't really understand. Next slide, Tim. You know, here's our Quick Mart down in the Taco Hut. The LEDs would be, or the neon would be fine in our city. But the LED dotted light would be fine. This all would be just fine, according to the new ordinance. But is it bright? Is it offensive? Is it the LED rope lighting? Yeah, sure is. Next slide. This is down at the Kroger Center, and you'll notice that the street light and the big pedestal sign there are actually brighter than the rope lighting for the little ice cream shack or the little snow cone shack that's sitting out there. So what are we, is it brightness of light? Is it, what is it really about this rope lighting that's irritating? Is it the type of business? Well, you know, we have all types of businesses, and there's some businesses that I don't go to that I don't like, but we have them. Monterey Grill, this one was cool. He has LEDs, but they're pointed inside. You can still see them from the street, and they change colors. They go through a whole rainbow, and they flash. Right next door, I think, is a window display that's probably more offensive to a lot of people in the Bible Belt, which is Priscilla McCall's and the lingerie models that were stacked up in the windows. But our ordinances don't deal with that because we don't deal with offensive or things that irritate. So if we're going to deal with lumens, let's talk about lumens. This, by the way, ordinance won't handle. This is the Cricket store right down here on Main Street. You know, they just have floodlights. LED floodlights just beaming right out into the parking lot. You can't even see what the signs are. It's so bright. I didn't doctor this photo. This is go out there tonight. But this wouldn't be covered. So, you know, to me, the irritation, the what should we deal with as city council should be based on an objective standard. To me, that's a lumens standard. Tim, any more? Yeah, next one. Yeah, these are just different ones that we've seen around the city. That's if you see it in the distance, that's a Landmark Grill. And their windows are all done in red LEDs, but they're not nearly as bright as some of the newer ones. Looks fine. I don't have an issue with it. The bright ones, they bug the snot out of me. But you know, there's a lot of signs that bug the snot out of me. There's the plastic palm trees. Those bug the snot out of me, but they're gone now. There's the Memorial Park LED light sign that we have. That thing is brighter than 1,000 dying suns. I wish we could figure out how to make it like the one on Main Street so it wasn't quite so bright. You know, Sarah's Secret and their billboards. I don't like those either, but we live in a place where there's things we don't like. Now, for me, I'd much rather see us deal with an objective standard with a lumens-based. So if somebody wants to put rope lights up, that's fine, as long as it doesn't exceed a total amount of lighting per that frontage. And there's plenty of ordinances out there today, model ordinances, that do that. So I'll look forward to seeing that kind of an ordinance come up, and then we can, at that point, say, okay, rope lightings, you've got 36 months to phase them out, and we're done. And I think that's a lot easier, it's a lot less painful, it's an objective standard, it makes it easy for code enforcement, makes it easy for our businesses, and that's why I'm going to say no on this one. Thanks, Tim, appreciate it.
Okay. Phase them out or turn them down?
Yeah, phase them out, turn them down, however, absolutely.
Councilman Vaughn, do you have anything? I want to come back to him since he made the motion to start with.
Well, Mayor, I feel like we've pretty much beat this horse to death. Everybody has stated their objections and their, and those that are for it also stated it. As I tried to point out in an earlier meeting, to go along with Councilman Gilmore's point, I thought when we even considered looking at this, that we should have also at the same time been looking at the strength of the lighting. I don't see a point in right now voting to do away with a certain type of lighting when we get to whatever January or whenever that may happen, that they may be well below whatever the standard is that we set. And on the other side of the coin, I see that, I hear the figure that there's 31 businesses now, and in January, that figure, someone threw out 120.
I was just guessing. That was just random.
So are we looking to grandfather 120 of them as opposed to 30 now? I think we need to reevaluate this. I am not in favor of this regulation as it's printed. Okay. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Councilman Ferguson.
I still favor this. Obviously, if it weren't objective, it wouldn't be enforceable. It would never have made it past the city attorney's office. So it has a very objective standard. We could take the notion that until we can find a mosquito spray that kills every mosquito, we shouldn't bother spraying because we'll only get part of them. I don't agree with that, and I don't agree with this either. The notion that if we can't wipe out all of the things that we want to take care of in one ordinance, that we should just wait until someday we figure out what that would look like. Okay. You can solve a problem, and a lot of times problems get solved in pieces, or you can wait until there is the be-all, end-all solution that may or may not come. So my opinion is, like spraying mosquitoes, I spray the ones I can kill now, and when better technology comes to, or a better way comes to figure out how to kill the rest of them, I kill them then. We've been under intense pressure from citizens for a long period of time to improve the look of this city, to improve the retail of this city, and to sit here tonight and say, well, I don't want to take action because I can do that another day. I wouldn't want to be the one saying that to the citizens who expect this council to move forward and get done what it can get done when it can get it done.
Okay, thank you. Before we turn this over to the counselor to read it back, we have a motion and a second on the floor. Does anybody need to have that repeated back to them? Does anybody need that?
Wasn't there an amendment to that motion?
I presented it with the
okay
additional language.
Okay.
So no.
Nobody needs that? Councilman Vaughn, is that okay with you?
That's
okay.
Fine, sir.
Okay. Counselor?
This is an ordinance of the City Council of the City of Lewisville, Texas, amending Chapter 11 signs of the Lewisville City Code by adding regulations related to LED or other continuous or connected series of lights, providing for repeal, providing for severability, providing a penalty, providing an effective date, and declaring an emergency.
Okay. All those in favor of this ordinance, raise your hand. Okay, we have Councilman Ferguson and Councilman Daniels. All those opposed, raise your hand. Okay, Councilman Tierney, Councilman Vaughn, and Councilman Gilmore are against it. Motion does not pass. Thank you.
Mayor, I wish that citizens would get as fired up about every issue as they did about lights tonight. So I hope to see you all back, those of you who are here commenting. Would love to see you back or give more input, because quite frankly, I didn't hear anything in my personal email. I got no phone calls on this. I got nothing. So it would be nice to get more of that feedback, and not just on Facebook.
Okay. We'll move on to item number 9. This is an ordinance adding fees related to LELA. Comments: so the Parks Department will assume operation of the LELA entrance gate August 17th, 2015. And the entrance fees needed to be established in the fee ordinance. Recommendation is that the City Council approve the ordinance as set forth in the caption above. Councilman Vaughn?
Mayor, I make a motion that we approve the ordinance as set forth.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion by Councilman Vaughn, a second by Councilman Ferguson. Counselor?
This is an ordinance of the City Council of the City of Lewisville, Texas, amending the Lewisville City Code, Chapter 2, Section 2-201, fee schedule, adding certain fees for Lewisville Area Lake Environmental Learning Area, providing a repealer, providing for severability, providing an effective date, and declaring an emergency.
Okay, is there any additional discussion on this? Okay. We have a motion and a second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, say nay. Motion carries unanimously. Item 10 is an ordinance establishing a wastewater main extension project in agreement with Prestige Garage LLC for oversizing of sanitary sewer improvements to 985 East State Highway 121 business. Comments are the ordinance establishes a reimbursement to Prestige Garage for the installation cost of a sanitary sewer from future users desiring to tie onto the line on a prorated basis based on share of the sewer shed. The agreement will reimburse Prestige Garage for oversizing the sanitary sewer per the Elm Fork trunk sanitary sewer study to be constructed with the proposed development. The amount of $65,113.12 covers the difference in cost to be borne by the city between a 12-inch sanitary sewer requirement by the development and an 18-inch sanitary sewer as shown in the East Side Sanitary Sewer Study. Recommendation is that the City Council approve the ordinance in agreement with Prestige Garage LLC as set forth in the caption above. Councilman Daniels.
Move to approve.
Second.
We have a motion to approve by Councilman Daniels and a second by Councilman Vaughn. Any discussion? Okay, Councilor.
This is an ordinance of the City Council of the City of Lewisville, Texas, establishing a wastewater main extension project, establishing extension fees, providing for a repealer, providing a severability clause, and declaring an emergency.
Okay, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, say nay. Motion carries unanimously. Item 11. This is an amendment to an existing agreement between TxDOT and the city to add the maintenance of signals at FM 423 and Lake Highlands Drive. Administrative comments. TxDOT is constructing a new signal at the intersection of Lake Highlands Drive and FM 423. TxDOT has requested that the city include this signal within the other signals presently maintained along FM 423. The city will be reimbursed for the maintenance of this signal as set forth in the existing agreement. Recommendation is that the City Council approve the agreement as set forth in the caption above. Councilman Tierney.
Move to approve.
Second.
We have a motion to approve by Councilman Tierney and a second by Councilman Ferguson. Any discussion? Okay. City Attorney? Nothing on this one? Okay. We have a motion and a second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, say nay. Motion carries unanimously. Number 12, this is a resolution regarding the delivery of unsolicited or unsubscribed newspapers on private property as requested by Councilman Vaughn. Administrative comments are at the request of Councilman Vaughn. City staff met with concerned resident to discuss the delivery of unsolicited or unsubscribed newspapers on private property. As a result of this meeting, city staff has prepared a resolution for City Council consideration. Recommendation is that City Council consider the resolution as set forth in the caption above. Councilman Vaughn. I've got it. Yeah. Do you want to do that one first? Okay. Colonel Mason is here to speak to be in support, but does not wish to speak, but is available for any questions. Is that correct, sir? Thank you. So he is here available. Councilman Vaughn?
Yes, Mayor. This item was brought to the attention of a couple of members of the City Council regarding the right of the Lewisville citizens to object to having newspapers thrown on their property when they did not want the newspaper, did not pay for the newspaper, or even request it. And it came to our attention that the citizens were being put in a catch-22 in the sense that constitutionally we're told by the attorney that we can't stop the newspapers from throwing the newspaper. And consequently, on the other side of the coin, the city, if you don't do something with those newspapers or get them up, collect them, or do whatever, the city has the right to fine you. They have never fined anybody, but it's my understanding that they do write tickets for this offense. And so after talking to a couple of members of the community who anticipate with the passing of this resolution that they are going to have the footing they need to pursue this on the next level. That's all, Mayor.
Okay.
Thank you.
You have a motion on that?
Yes. I make a motion that we approve the resolution as stated.
Okay.
Second.
Second by Councilman Gilmore. Any discussion?
I have a question. You alluded to a next level. What is the next level?
Well, it's my understanding, I don't have any, it is beyond whatever that level is, it's beyond the city at this point. The idea is to, I guess Colonel Merson could talk about this more than I can, but the idea is that they have, the problem is the way we're interpreting, I guess, the constitutional right of the newspaper, and the we are saying that we don't want to be responsible for fining the citizens when our ordinances are the way they are. And we cannot, there are a couple of, there's some hazards in not dealing with these newspapers. They clog up the system, they promote infestation and that sort of thing. Yeah, so Colonel Mason has proposed that he has a web page started and he has some community support that I would imagine. Colonel, would you like to say what that might be, where you're headed with this? Please.
The question was, what would be the next level that this
resolution
would allow you to take?
And Mr. Mason, when you get there, if you would state your name and address for the record, please.
Yes, thank you all. I'm Colonel Mason, 1249 Bel Air, Louisville, Texas, 75067.
Thank you, sir.
It's been a problem for me for 20 years. I'm having trouble getting around. I'm on a slope. If I don't walk down and pick up the newspapers, I get threatened with a fine by the city. And the city, of course, has the right to do that because of unsightly matter, but I have no control over the newspapers being thrown on my yard. I have neighbors who have been there longer than me and have the same complaint. In fact, is I'm getting complaints from other cities that this is a problem.
Okay, this was all in the material we were provided. So,
Pardon?
I said all of that was provided in this material that we were given. The question is, what is the next level that you would be able to pursue?
Well, if the city does not approve of newspapers being wantonly thrown on private property without permission, then this allows our citizens committee to talk to the merchants who support that activity and ask them to please refrain, because good citizens do not litter. And the newspapers claim to be good citizens, and they are in many ways, but good citizens do not trash other people's property.
So have you not been able to speak to those people previously? Why would this enable being able to speak to them?
Well, this is official agreement by the city that the newspapers are a nuisance.
Okay.
When they're thrown on people's property for various reasons stated in the resolution. This allows official recognition that that is happening. I talked to the EPA this morning. They're quite interested in Louisville's position on this.
So your expectation is that this resolution is going to give you added sway? Is that, I mean,
yes,
that's the answer I'm looking for.
Yes, merely the fact that the resolution, although it has no legal standing, gives added sway because the city as a whole would prefer the newspapers be delivered to homes where they are subscribed to and appreciated and wanted, or by U.S. mail in the mailbox, or perhaps even hung on doors.
And
but not wantonly thrown on private property and allowed to mount up in the rain and the snow and to wash into sewers and to do other things that, quite frankly, we citizens of Louisville are paying the city of Louisville to clean up. And also the newspapers find their way to landfills because they're come in plastic bags. So we're paying for the landfill of these newspapers.
Okay.
It's insanity.
And of course, it's all protected by
case law. So the newspapers under the First Amendment have the right to litter, and they're hiding behind that right, and all we're trying to do is bring it into light, into the open, of what they are doing. Okay. Responsible citizens don't litter.
Okay, but you...
Thank you, Colonel Mason.
Did that answer the question?
Thank you, sir. I did get the answer. Okay.
Did it answer your question, Neil?
Well, I gather the answer is that they've spoken with the people who are delivering these papers, and they feel that the resolution will add weight to speaking to them again. So that's the from your comment when you mentioned taking it to another level.
Yes.
I thought it implied some other level of authority, but that's not the case, correct?
Well, not necessarily. As support, hopefully, bills for this, as the Colonel stated, the EPA has been in contact, or he's been in contact with them.
Okay.
And so it could it could possibly turn out that Louisville might be the model for any action that takes place further on up.
So was the EPA the other level you were referencing then?
The EPA?
Okay.
No, I wasn't the level I was referencing.
Okay.
I was referencing the support that the community, his committee or whatever you choose to call them, to help them build up their argument. That's the next level.
I'm not opposed to this. I'm just trying to understand what it really accomplishes.
Well, as the Colonel says, legally, it doesn't hold any weight legally.
Okay.
Is there any further discussion?
I think my question was just answered. What does this resolution actually
accomplish? That was my question too.
Okay. That's all I got, Mayor.
Well, it adds
In support of it.
It adds sway to the argument that they're trying to make.
Okay.
That
and
the
I'm,
city
and I am in support of it.
That the city shares their same arguments with the problem.
Absolutely. I move to approve.
Second.
We already have a motion.
You already have a motion.
We already have
table.
A motion and a second.
Is there already? Did you already second?
Yeah, second.
And a second already.
Third.
There's a motion and a second on the floor. Any further discussion? Okay. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, say nay. Motion carries unanimously. Thank you.
Thank you, Colonel.
Thank you, Colonel Mason. Okay. Item 13, provide direction to staff regarding GO bond program for inclusion in the required election ordinance. Comments or the election ordinance must be adopted at the August 17, 2015 City Council meeting in order to call a November election. Recommendation is that the City Council provide direction to staff regarding GO bond program for inclusion in the required election ordinance. Councilman Ferguson.
Yes, my understanding is a motion is preferred on this item. So I would move that we approve the GO bond program presented with an added consideration that we first hear back what the options are for including the aquatics portion of the Parks and Rec part of this overall program as either a separate item or as a contingent item.
Okay.
Does that sum it up?
I think that gives you direction. Okay.
I believe so.
Is there a second on that?
I'll second that.
Second? Oh, go ahead,
TJ?
We can arm wrestle over it.
Okay. I heard TJ. Second by Councilman Gilmore. Any discussion? Okay. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, say nay. Thank you. Motion carries unanimously. Reports. Nika? Okay. Chief? Russ, go ahead.
Yes, sir, Mayor. I just want to remind those in the audience and those watching at home that our next session of the Citizen Police Academy begins August 27th. There's still room for folks to get in, so, you know, they're not to worry about that. If they've got interest in that, they can contact Officer Alvin Bilby at 972-219-3608. Thanks, sir.
Why don't you repeat that number one more time?
Yes. I sound like those commercials. 972-219-3608.
Thank you, Russ. Lake level?
Still 8 feet above conservation, but it's ticking down a little bit daily, and Councilman Ferguson always likes facts, so I did get information today that since July, the week of July 27th, the water supply in the state of Texas has gone down by 60,000 acre feet, so what goes up can come down just as quickly, so it, but we are in good shape.
Okay, thank you. Nothing in? Mr. Ferris? Nothing.
If you want a fall vegetable garden, you have to get started on it now. And tomorrow night at the City Annex, Keep Louisville Beautiful has their Garden Secrets class, Fall Vegetable Gardening. There are still spots available, because if you don't start planting now and start planting ahead, you can't harvest later on. So be aware of that. And then also I want to just put a plug in, since we're talking about Keep Louisville Beautiful, there are many adopt-a-spots out there that can still be adopted by families, by businesses, by individuals, and I encourage everybody to take a look at that. You just take a small section, and if we section up the city and everybody can keep their part of it clean, it makes a better-looking city. So I encourage everybody to take a look at that.
Okay. Councilman Tierney?
Nothing, sir.
Okay. Councilman Gilmore?
Mayor, this August 15th, Saturday, from 10 a.m. to 5 p.m., is our second annual Clear the Shelter adoption event. Last year, it was a stunning success throughout the entire Metroplex. So if you are looking to add to your winter warmth by having a dog or cat sleep on your feet, now is the time. So schedule that, and you can't put an animal on reserve. You need to be there that day and find a loving friend to take them out of that shelter. Even though it's a beautiful facility, I know they don't want to stay there. That's all I have.
City Manager?
No, sir.
Okay. Councilman Ferguson?
Yes, Mayor. MCL Grand, we have a live performance coming up also on August 15th. Single performance, Water from a Rock, presented by Watchman Media Productions. I think this is tied to one of the local churches. I'm not sure. We have a public event, Visual Arts League Jam Sessions, always on Friday nights, and very popular. Welcome anyone who wants to come and participate or just listen. Art exhibits, we have an exhibit by six UNT art students, and that will open also on August 15th. It's going to be a popular day, in the gallery, entitled As Above, So Below. So you can make out of that what you want. And then a photography exhibit that opens also on August 15th, Altered Processes in the North Corridor Gallery. And I believe that's the Visual Arts League that has that presentation. And just like they do on TV, want to remind you that that number for Citizens Police Academy is 972-219-3608.
Thank you. Councilman Vaughn?
Nothing, Mayor.
Councilor? City Secretary? Officer, thanks for being here tonight, and I want to thank you for your service and all the other members of the police department. Thank you. Okay. Next item is closed session. In accordance with Texas Government Code, Subchapter D, Item 1, Section 551.071, legal issues related to the construction of Old Town Park Plaza, Item 2, Section 551.071, consultation with attorney, pending litigation, City of Louisville versus City of Farmers Branch and Camelot Landfill LP, cause number 412-CV-0078-2, U.S. District Court for Eastern District of Texas, Sherman Division, TCEQ modification to municipal solid waste permit number 1312A, and TCEQ application to obtain municipal solid waste permit amendment permit number 1312B. Item 3, Section 551.072, Real Estate Property Acquisition. Item 4, Section 551.074, Personnel Annual Staff Reviews. City Manager Donna Barron, City Secretary Julie Heinze, City Attorney Elizabeth Plaster, Chief Municipal Court Judge Brian Holman, and alternate municipal court judges. Item 5, Section 551.087, Economic Development, Deliberation Regarding Economic Development Negotiations. We'll now go into closed session. It would reconvene into open session. Council, is there any action to be taken?
Move to adjourn.
We have a motion by Councilman Ferguson to adjourn. Who's the second on that?
Second.
Second by Councilman Tierney. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Good night.